In my opinion, it shows strength. Because the easiest thing I could do, okay, go ahead, knock out 15 different major things in Iran. I think it shows far more strength to do it the way we're doing it. The thing that does show strength would be showing a little bit of restraint.
Kayla, when you're reporting at CNBC on the market and business and you're following these sanctions, it's already been maximum pressure from the U.S. on Iran. What do these new sanctions mean for the Iranian economy and the Iranian leadership?
Well, we're getting pretty close to an economic blockade where essentially the U.S., to exert any more pressure than it already has, would essentially have to bar any company, any country from doing any business with Iran. We're not there yet. And clearly there seems to not quite be a coalition behind President Trump here. I mean, this is going to really come up next week at the UN General Assembly. But European countries, they're trying to uphold the old deal. They're trying to extend a financial lifeline to Iran. And so President Trump is between a rock and a hard place here. He doesn't really have a military option here. Gas prices would skyrocket. You'd have a recession going into an election year. And he ran in 2016 on ending military conflict, not increasing military conflict. So he's really in a difficult position. And it appears that Iran, with these various strikes, is trying to call his bluff.
And Vivian, you've been a bureau chief in Baghdad for the Associated Press, now with the Wall Street Journal. Saudi Arabia and the Crown Prince bin Salman have a scattered, spotty record on human rights, including the death of Jamal Khashoggi, a Washington Post writer. Why is the U.S. so aligned with Saudi Arabia despite that human rights record?
Well, money. To put it brief, I mean, that's the brief explanation behind it. And President Trump said it very bluntly this week. He said the Saudis pay cash. That is literally how he looks at it, where he says, listen, we can overlook some of that human rights stuff and other things because at the end of the day, they're going to buy American products. They're going to keep jobs flowing. They're going to pump money into our economy. And that to us is okay. And that's going to be our priority. And so even as all of this stuff was going on, he was saying the Saudis pay cash. We need to stay connected with them. But when asked, are you going to defend, have you promised Saudi Arabia that you're going to defend them if a war, it comes out to war? He said, I never promised anyone anything. So that's the thing. Even with that relationship, he's reluctant to get involved in a war.
Well, there's so many contradictory impulses here because before he was president, Donald Trump had this long record of saying, you know, Saudi Arabia is ripping us off. We defend them. They don't pay enough money. It's not our job to defend Saudi Arabia. Now he sees that we do a lot of business with Saudi Arabia. You know, he's got good relationships. His son, Jared Kushner, is very close to the Crown Prince. And then, you know, I was struck by what Kayla was saying, which I think is exactly right, that he doesn't have good military options here. I think he very much does not want a military conflict that could rattle the global economy as he heads into his reelection campaign. At the same time, he loves the power of the presidency. So what a display at the White House today where he's signaling, I'm going to be patient, I'm going to show restraint, but he can't resist talking about, we've modernized our nuclear forces, our nuclear is like it's never been before. Who's talking about nuclear weapons right now? Why is he saying this?
If I wanted
and
to.
And even, yeah. I have to just get this in, he said, I could order a strike, in fact, I could do it in 1 minute, I could do it with all of you guys right here, almost like he was fantasizing about starting a war in front of the press corps,
yet,
but I don't think he'll do it.
Yet, he's non-interventionist to this point. And he's not listening to some of his top allies on Capitol Hill, like Senator Lindsey Graham of South Carolina. Is that because, even though he sometimes hires people like John Bolton as National Security Advisor and plays golf with Senator Graham, is he a non-interventionist? Is that how Republicans see him?
I think so far he has shown himself in action to be more of a non-interventionist, but I think Republicans don't know the answer to that. And the other person that he talks to a lot and plays golf with is Rand Paul, who is decidedly a non-interventionist. So he sort of has these two voices, one on either shoulder, all the time. This was a night where Rand Paul, I think, came out more with what he wants. But it's really interesting, in this whole Saudi Arabia area, it's fascinating to me because this is the area where the president has the greatest divide with Republicans in Congress. They do not trust Saudi Arabia. They do not want us involved in Yemen. The president has pushed forward. They voted four times to try and override his Saudi Arabia policy. His veto power allows it to continue. So it's a very precarious area for him politically.
What has this done, this whole, the U.S. is on the brink of war with Iran, meant for the oil markets and the global economy this week? Has that been a factor for the administration as they thought through this decision tonight?
Sure. When you see major correspondents for the nightly newscasts on Monday night standing outside of gas stations talking about skyrocketing prices for U.S. consumers, I mean, that's exactly the scenario that the president wants to avoid. He's talked about energy deregulation, how prices are getting lower for people. Clearly, we saw the Saudi economy able to jump back very quickly. I mean, they really got their production levels, I think, back in record time. Everyone was surprised that all of a sudden everything was okay. But I do think that it raises some real questions about what does the U.S. do with the strategic petroleum reserve? The administration was going to sell off a bunch of that to raise cash to try to plug part of the deficit. And now maybe they're reconsidering, do we need that just in case this gets worse?
What about the new national security advisor, Robert O'Brien? What does his involvement in these discussions mean for U.S. foreign policy and with the decision with Iran?
Well, it's more a question of what John Bolton's absence from these conversations do, because obviously John Bolton, his predecessor, was very hawkish on Iran, probably more so than most. He was very much viewed an aggressive approach to Iran as the right approach. What little we know about Robert O'Brien's like global view is that he was also a hawk. In his book, he said that Iran is the sworn enemy of the United States, but he's probably much more moderate than John Bolton was, and so it'll be interesting to see what he does. The question is, where does President Trump go from here? I mean, in terms of, we're going to the UN next week. He wants to form a coalition. He's been skeptical about the UN. He's condemned the EU. And he's not meeting with any GCC leaders. The Russians are not there. The Israelis are not there. The Germans are not there. They're not meeting with him. The French are not meeting with him.
And
who's left?
The architect of his previous Iran strategy is also not there.
Exactly.
Who's left? He is meeting. Sorry, go ahead. But he is meeting with the Ukrainian President Zelensky, which will be fine. But I'm sorry.
And Boris Johnson, who has his own problems.
The question that I heard raised most often today was not what do we know about O'Brien, but who is he going to choose for his staff? That will send the clearest signal about the direction of this recalibration, if we should call it that, on Iran and who he chooses to essentially signal where his policy will go.
Part of it, the rest of the world is engaging with Iran. China has its own relationship with Iran. Europe wants to see the Iran deal come back.
Yeah, and I think that's, China in particular has been moving forward with some really major investments involving Iran. And, you know, one risk here is that Trump isolates the United States and the rest of the world kind of moves in. And, you know, Trump is in this showdown with China economically, but it's not clear that we can prevent the Iranians and potentially the Russians and other countries from kind of taking advantage of this opportunity and building a relationship. And if there comes a point where Iran's oil comes back online, the U.S. sort of loses this confrontation, that's very profitable on that side of the world, and the U.S. is left out of it. The president is playing a dangerous and risky game here, and you know Robert O'Brien is really personally well like the new national security advisor. He does not have deep, shall we say, strategic credentials and experience within federal bureaucracy. So with the president, there's a lot going on, and he doesn't have necessarily the most experienced team you would want.
Final thought: Congress, if there is action taken, will there be a push, pressure, to have authorization on Capitol Hill?
Oh, absolutely. Not from everyone, but from many members. They're very uncomfortable.
Republicans?
I think there will be a few Republicans, but I want to see how they vote. In the past, we saw Republicans, like maybe a Bob Corker, say something and then sort of vote with the president, get cowed down. There's not a tremendous amount of public bravery from Republicans in public, but certainly there will be an outcry. Look at, you know, Senator Kaine from Virginia. There will be others. Congress is supposed to declare war, so if there is military action, you'll hear about it.